Hi friends, I am Dr. Krishna Subramaniam from Hyderabad. First of all, let me congratulate and thank the IPS Executive Committee for the Indian Arthroscopy Society Online Learning Project. I am going to speak today about how we do MPFL reconstruction in the situation of recurrent dislocation of patella due to post-trauma tear of the medial patellofemoral ligament today. One should know what is MPFL. A brief anatomy is, it is present as an extracapsular, extraarticular condensation of the medial retinaculum of a length of around close to 6 centimeters on the medial aspect of the knee joint, spanning between the medial femoral condyle to the medial surface of the patella. It primarily functions to restrain the lateral displacement of the patella in the flexor position of the knee joint. Coming to the anatomy of the MPFL, on the femoral side, there are two important bony landmarks. That is, that's the medial epicondyle of the femur, and that is the medial border of the patella. So the condensation of the medial retinaculum as MPFL spans between the two bony landmarks, and it is on the patellar side at the junction of the proximal and middle one third of the medial border of the patella for a width of about close to 3 centimeters. As I told, the primary function of the medial patellofemoral ligament is to prevent the lateral pulling forces on the patella to balance it. And usually post-traumatic, the MPFL tears at the femoral side more commonly, and sometimes associated with avulsions also. And next is the patellar side, and rarely in the midsections of the medial patellofemoral ligament. This is a pictorial diagram of the X-ray and the MRI to show very clearly the tear of the medial patellofemoral ligament, and that's how the tilt of the patella, not only the tilt, but all the lateral displacement of the patella is seen following the tear of the MPFL. Then once we identify, how do we evaluate when the patient comes? Most important point is we have to check for the overall limb alignment to assess not only the MPFL, but also are there any other causes for the recurrent dislocation of the patella, like a bony structure problems, like an abnormal attachment of the patellar tendon to the tibial tuberosity, abnormal position of the tibial tuberosity, or is there an excessive Q angle, etc. Having ruled out all these things, one has to palpate at the MPFL lengthwise. And if there is a tenderness associated with the hematrosis and the crepitus, which shows that there is a definitive injury to the medial patellofemoral ligament. And also we need to check for the patellar glide test and apprehension test to know the recurrence of the dislocation of the patella. And lastly, we have to check the patellar tracking. If there is any abnormality of patellar tracking, one has to again look into the other causes of recurrent dislocation of the patella. And based on the time and type of the tear, MPFL tear can be an acute tear or it can be chronic tear. If it is an acute tear, the results of the repair of the torn MPFL in the literature are really not encouraging, because there is a possibility of 20% failure rate. The repair is shown better outcome in types of avulsion injuries rather than mid-substance tear or retinacular tear itself. Imbrications have uniformly shown a high failure rate. Therefore, if there is any chronic MPFL tear, reconstruction shows the best results in the literature. It is almost showing 94% of the success rate following the MPFL repairs, reconstruction. Then what are the indications? Recurrent dislocation of patella itself is not an indication for MPFL because recurrent dislocation of patella etiology is multifactorial. So whenever there is a post-traumatic MPFL VMO mechanism is altered due to injury, that is the indication for the MPFL reconstruction. It can be added at an adjuvant procedure whenever there is a tracheoplasty is being done, or if there is any distal rearrangement procedures like a tibial tuberosity transfer or Galea procedure, or if there is any varus femoral osteotomy, this can be added as a adjuvant procedure. Then what are the goals of MPFL reconstruction? One has to remember that MPFL do not keep the patella in the trochlea. Whenever there is flexion of the knee joint, MPFL establishes a natural chacrine against the lateral patellar movement in the trochlea. Therefore, MPFL is useful to keep the patellar gliding in the normal limits in the trochlea whenever the knee is taken from extension to flexion and flexion to extension. Then what are the various contraindications? The absolute contraindication is whenever there is a congenital dislocation of the patella, that means entire quadriceps mechanism is at fault, and there is a habitual dislocation of the patella, that means there are other bony causes to cause that patella to be dislocated with every knee flexion. And whenever there is associated bony trochlea dysplasia, this is one of the contraindications. Then patellofemoral arthrosis, it's not an absolute contraindication, but relative contraindication to the MPFL reconstruction. Once again, the youngsters have to remind and remember that MPFL is not meant to pull the patella into the position while it glides or while it slides. It stabilizes the located patella against the excessive lateral forces. This has to be remembered because whenever we are doing a MPFL, excessive tightening of the MPFL should not be done surgically. Then what are the various surgical steps? Having examined the patient under anesthesia, overall limb alignment, then the patella anatomy itself, the trochlea, patellar gliding, sliding, the dislocatability, everything, then do a gentle diagnostic arthroscopy quickly to assess post-traumatic if there are any avulsion injuries, are there any loose bodies because of the avulsion tracts of the articular surface or the patella, one has to rule out. Then harvest the hamstring graft, usually graceless, and prepare it. Usually we need a 20 to 22 centimeters for the length of the graft. Then the first incision is on the medial side of the medial border of the patella. It is extracapsular, extra-articular, extra-periosteal dissection. Then the second incision is on the femoral fixation site, and the bony landmark is medial epicondyle. Then prepare the patellar side and femoral side by making troughs using K-voids and appropriate drills. Usually we require 4mm drills or 4.5 mm drills on the patellar side, and based on the graft thickness, we may require 6mm or 6.5 mm drill bit and drill on the femoral side. Then fix the graft on the patellar side using a simple swivel lock. Then pass the graft extracapsularly under the subcutaneous tissue on the medial side, and then fix the graft on the femoral side under appropriate tension. But here, the appropriate proper tension of the fixation of the graft is not mentioned anywhere in the literature. Then the first video, now we can show the first video. That is how we mark the patella surface marking with this on the femoral side. And that's how, that's a routine way of harvesting the graft. Usually we harvest the gracilis, which is usually identified very easily in the pessimist. That's how, using a closed or open tendon stripper, we can just harvest the graft and prepare the graft the entire length. Then the first incision is on the, you can observe, we are now dissecting extra-articular, extra-capsular and the medial border, along the medial border of the patella. You can appreciate nicely in our video, that's how, that is along the medial border of the patella, nicely. Having done that, under the Sion image intensifier, before preparing the guide wire and drill, we do a arthroscopy, and the dissection is extra-articular, extra-capsular, using a long hemostat. You can see the impressions of the hemostat from within the capsule. We can appreciate nicely. That's how we dissect nicely under the subcutaneous tissue, extra-capsularly. Having dissected that, and that's how we pass the drill wires. First one is at the upper border and around 1 centimeter below the upper border of the patella and the medial aspect. The second one is another 1 to 1.5 centimeters. You can see nicely how we pass parallel to the K wire, and this is the lateral view where the guide wires are in the mid substance of the patellar bone itself, not on the equidistance between the articular surface and the dorsal surface of the patella very nicely. This is a true lateral view. And then the next one is that's how the graft is nicely prepared. We check the length, whether the length is sufficient or not. And then the femoral isometric point. And this is a very, very important point. And that usually we calculate by using a device, and this is called Schottel's point. You draw a parallel line along the posterior aspect of the femoral cortex along the length, and another perpendicular line, imaginary line, along the posterior articular surface of the patella. The meeting point is a Schottel point. You can see that's a diagrammatic representation. This is a radiographic Sion image. And once we do, we pass the guide wire. You can see that we, that's how we identify. Once again, the Schottel insertion point is around 2.5 millimeters distal to the posterior cortical line intersecting with the perpendicular drawn from the posterior articular surface like this of the femoral condyle. That's how we can identify. And then we pass the guide wire under the image intensifier guidance. That's how we can see paraoperatively. And then having checked the graft size, usually we drill to 6 to 6.5 millimeters. We usually drill 30 millimeters. That's enough usually. And that's how our biocomposite screw length is sufficient. Usually we keep 28 mm biocomposite screw. You can see that's how we drill. Once we do the drill, first we fix the graft on the patellar side with the knee flexion. That's how the swivel lock. A simple, very, very simple way we can fix on the truss on the what we prepared. See, that's how both the limbs of the graft are kept on the patellar side. Having done, we pass the graft under the subcutaneous tissue extracapsularly, again, if necessary, under arthroscopy guidance. You can see the hemostat is being passed and the lead sutures are being pulled very nicely subcutaneously, and that's the MPFL graft. That's how we pass. Then, what is the ideal tension of the MPL graft fixation? In the literature, there is no uniformity, but it's always logical to fix the graft with the knee in 30 to 40 degrees of flexion under reasonable maximum tension. Once again, remember the point that MPFL is not pulled the patella medially. Patella should not be pulled medially by reconstructed ligament. That's why I showed the arthroscopic picture. Excessive pulling will cause patellofemoral pain postoperatively and stiffness. The patellar lateral translocation beyond the lateral margin of the trochlea should be prevented. That's the key point. Then the fixation of the graft is done under arthroscopic guidance. You can see the reconstructed graft limbs extracapsularly and extraarticularly very nicely. You can see very nicely. And then once you fix the graft, you see the patella tracking arthroscopically. And these are the post-op x-rays nicely being shown in the lateral view. That is the fixation point on the femoral side, and these are the patellar side and the upper half of the medial border of the patella. You can see in skyline view, the patella is nicely being placed in the trochlea, and you can see, and it is nicely showing parallelism of the articular surface of the patella and the trochlea very nicely. That means the patella is nicely gliding in the merchant's view. Then after doing, what is the rehab program? Usually we have to immobilize the knee with a hinge knee brace and restrict the RVM in the initial 1.5 months, and then start the progressive kinetic knee chain exercise from the second week onwards with the CPM, continuous passive motion, as the patient tolerates, from 0 to 30 degrees, 30 to 45 degrees, 45 to 65 degrees, and so on. Then we give the supported weight bearing from the third week with the protected weight bearing of walker. Then start the muscle strengthening exercise from the end of 1.5 months once patient gains the complete knee range of movement. And after 12 weeks, we start agility training. That's how the rehab is done. You can see the post-operative picture of the young girl, which we reconstructed nicely on both sides. You can see. And these are the post-operative videos after of the same patient after 6 months. No extensor lag, complete extension and full range of movement of the knee joint as compared to the opposite side. You can see very beautifully on both sides. And that's how the MPFL reconstruction is done. And my friends, every surgery has its own complications. The common complications in MPFL reconstruction are pain and stiffness. The pain and stiffness are usually transient. That is because of it, too much tightening of the graft and too much tensioning of the graft. Then remember that patella fracture, especially the upper pole of the patella, because of the drilling of the bony tunnels. And another one is penetration of the one of the cortices if your guide wire is not in the substance of the patellar bone. If the other bony factors are not addressed, the MPFL reconstruction is going to fail and patient does develop recurrence of the dislocation of the patella. And every surgery has a possibility of infection. Commonly, it is a superficial infection and hematoma formation. These are the common complications. I have seen in my entire series of more than 25 cases in the last 5 years, one upper pole fracture, and that has been fixed and the patient was doing well now. Then in summary, we have to remember that MPFL is an important restrainer and balances the patella against the lateral dislocation in the patella. And therefore, it neutralizes to some extent the lateral petal are pulling forces. Remember that it's an extra-articular, extra-capsular structure in the second layer of the medial side of the knee joint. And it being a ligament, it is less elastic. Therefore, it has a tendency for easy rupturing. If it is an acute tear, you identify both clinically examination and your MRI examination of the patient. Possibility is there if there is an avulsion injury, repair it. If the patient presents late, the best thing is reconstruct using a simple technique what we have done. This is the basic technique any person can do very simple way. And the most important thing is too much tension in the graft causes postoperative stiffness and pain. Therefore, optimal graft tensioning in 30 to 40 degrees of knee flexion is key to the success of the MPFL reconstruction. And with this, I just conclude the MPFL reconstruction using a simple technique with the hamstring graft and swivel lock on both sides and a biocomposite screw on the femoral side. I sincerely thank the Indian Arthroscopy Society Executive Committee for giving me this opportunity to share my ideas and a basic reconstruction of MPFL reconstruction. Any surgeon, any arthroscopy surgeon can do this. It's a very simple technique. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Thank you.